Welcome to the Six Lessons Podcast, Episode 3. So today we're going to talk a little bit about the interaction of the six lessons, because there's never one lesson that's all you have to do. That's why there's six lessons. There's actually six ways to make a tooth hurt if you fix it. But if you don't fix it in a way that connects it side to side, front to back, and top to bottom, then you can have pain. And the pain are two sources. One, if you lose the hybrid layer, then you have a gap underneath the restoration where the hybrid layer has been disrupted, and that gap fills up with fluid, pulpal fluid. So you can have a sealed restoration on both sides, but then you can have a gap under the restorations filled with pulpal fluid. And when you chew on the restoration, the pulpal fluid is pushed towards the pulp. So that's the hydrodynamic source of pain. It was theorized by Mark Brandstrom in 1982 in his book, and 1986 is a great article on cracked tooth syndrome. But cracked teeth and gaps underneath restorations that cause pulpal fluid to move towards the pulp under mastication, those are the sources of pain on biting that patients feel. And so the idea of strengthening the hybrid layer as the greatest contribution to comfortable dentistry, and then the dissection of cracks is the second greatest contribution to keeping teeth pain-free under function. And then, of course, occlusion, which is lesson six, you have to adjust the occlusion so that it's in harmony with the other teeth as they bite down, and there's not one tooth getting more pressure into the PDL, which can be very painful if you have a tooth in hyperocclusion. But the idea of lesson one with caries, lesson two with cracks, lesson three with the hybrid layer, and then lesson four, these give us the ability to make sure that the seal at the bottom of our restoration is perfect. And so we will know that because there will not be fluid trapped underneath a restoration that may be sealed on both sides, but now it has that gap underneath the restoration after polymerization. And so the hybrid layer formation, which we talk about in detail in lesson three, is at risk of the polymerization stresses that can be generated in lesson four. And so the connection between lesson two, which is crack dissection, and lesson three and four, is that you now have introduced a preparation that, instead of being flat like a plate or even curved like a bowl, is now like a really narrow cup. But the idea is that if you have that, then the C factor, which is the ratio of bonded, unbonded surfaces, if you would bulk fill a restoration, becomes so high that you're guaranteed to lose a bond that has been tried to be established, but now is losing in its competition with other areas of the preparation that are bonding more quickly. And so these narrow preps that are the result of a dissected crack, these are a situation that are special to the six lessons, because we create now a potential problem by removing a real problem. So the risk and reward, the reward of taking out the crack is that now you have the ability to stop the movement of pulpal fluid from cracks opening and closing, but now you have the risk of creating a gap when you try to restore this high C factor dissection, or what we sometimes call a trench. How do you do that? I have an answer for you. It's called decoupling with time. Now, anybody that's followed my Instagram for the last 5 years, the idea is that this is science, and my approach in Instagram is to introduce everyone to the science, but Instagram hasn't been created to teach you the six lessons. In the reality, I am teaching professionally. I've been doing that for 20 years, actually 22 years. And so the teaching has been systematized. I have a system for teaching, and it covers all sorts of defects from decay, fracture, and trauma to the teeth. And so it does everything you need, but you have to learn it that certain things are more important and can't be compromised, all the way to occlusion, which occlusal adjustment is known by every dentist, and every dentist that has sensitivity or pain does an occlusal adjustment thinking that that will be something that will help. It can, but it has to be understood, what is the source of pain? What is the source of dental failures? I think that was our first episode in season two. What is the source of failure? Well, infections and gaps. And then we talked about how the cracks can propagate and become catastrophic. But then we talk about in lesson four and lesson two, the dissection of the cracks, and then we deal with these high C factor preparations when we do disrupt the cracks. And this is how we do it. We do immediate dentin sealing on all the walls. The immediate dentin sealing that we do on all the walls will be with a gold standard bonding system. A gold standard bonding system that is a self-etch system, a mild self-etch system, needs to have the smear layer that's been created in the preparation, which is just chopped up dentin as you're dissecting the crack. That smear layer needs to be removed or thinned, and that's called a conditioning step. Fusiyama's conditioning step that he innovated in 1980s and published in his book in 1993 again was phosphoric acid etching. Phosphoric acid etching has that advantage that it removes the smear layer, but it creates another problem. Solving one problem often creates another potential problem, and that was an inadequate infiltration of a hybrid layer, which could now be 5 microns thick if you use a total etch and remove all of the hydroxyapatite from the outer layers of the hybrid layer. The symbol that we use, the Alleman Center, has a symbolic meaning, as all symbols do. And this is, there are different layers in the hybrid layer. And these different layers have no hydroxyapatite on the outer layer, less hydroxyapatite removal on the next layer, which would mean more collagen is being covered with hydroxyapatite. And then this third layer is where the real rubber meets the road. A little bit of hydroxyapatite has been removed, allowing infiltration of the monomers. And when polymerized, this becomes like dentin. So this is the hybrid layer connection, and it's always less than a micron thick. These top layers can be 3 microns in thickness. Well, if you have 3 microns here, but the only one that counts is a 0.5 micron, you want to make sure that this doesn't interfere with the infiltration here. And that's what a self-etching system does. What it does is that it compresses all of these layers. So this outer layer where most of the hydroxyapatite is gone is very, very thin. So maybe it's like 100 nanometers. And then the next layer where you still have collagen that's been demineralized, but it's not demineralized totally like the outer layer, that might be another 100 nanometers in thickness. And so if the layer where the rubber meets the road is 500 nanometers in thickness, which is 0.5 micron, then this layer is thicker than these two layers put together with this approach of this bonding system, which is a mild self-etch bonding system. Now you might ask, but your hat has 4 layers. Thought you would never ask. The 4th layer here is actually dentin that has not been demineralized at all. Outer layer, the most demineralization. Next, less demineralization, just a little bit of demineralization on the important part of the hybrid layer. And then this part, no demineralization, only infiltration of hydrophilic monomers like HEMA, like 10-MDP, and like water. And that water molecule, obviously, is the carrier or the solvent that brings these monomers into this sound dentin. And this sound dentin gets infiltrated through what are called microtubules. You know, everybody knows what a dental tubule is. It's 1 micron in thickness. But a microtubular, again, isn't on the micron level, it's on the nanometer level, which connects the tubules. Wasn't even very well understood in Fusiyama's days. But now that we know that 20% of dentin is water, that's not 2%. That's not a small number. That's 20% of dentin is water. 30% is collagen. 50% hydroxyapatite. Enamel, 95% hydroxyapatite. And then 5%. Combination of water and a little bit of protein. But the idea is that now we have the ability to get underneath this important hybrid layer and make an area that's called a acid-base resistant zone that has been nicknamed by Tagami in 2009, and he calls it SuperDent. Simone Delaperi and I were in the audience at the International Association of Dental Research when 400 dentists heard this joke by Tagami, because he knew that in 2009, super in the United States, no marketing person in the world would say, this is super, because that's so 80s, right? And the 80s are like, super this, super that. No, you would never say super. But Tagami is very bright, very much above average. He knew what he was doing. He was playing with the audience, because he took off his glasses and he said, and we have found this phenomena, and we are going to call it a super dentin. So the nice little endearing accent, a super dentin, you know? And Simone and I look at each other like, he's playing with us. He's joking. And the whole audience was expecting some very scientific sounding phrase like acid-based resistance zone, you know, to call it a super dentin. I mean, it was beyond brilliant. It was funny. It's a memory that I've talked with Junji about, and he agrees that, you know, he was playing with the audience. He knew that a super was a passe term. But SuperDentin is, with the self-etching systems, the ability to make the hybrid layer not only totally resistant to low pH acid, but also totally resistant to high pH basic attacks. You can't dissolve this layer that is 1, even 2 microns thick. It can be very thick compared to these other layers, which are only a half a micron or 10th of a micron. But the superiority of the formation of the hybrid layer is really what the science, to me, shows to be the most exciting, because you don't need to cause a problem with pulpal fluid being introduced to your bonding fields with these self-etch, low pH systems that create SuperDent. Okay, so let's get back to our practical application. We've got a high C-factor preparation. It looks like a cup. It looks like a really skinny cup. And so you're making your hybrid layer on the sides. But again, it's only 1 micron above sound dentin and 1 micron below sound dentin. It's not thick at all. And so the sides, once the hybrid layer is created, there's no pulpal fluid coming in to the bonding field. We get a polymerization with the light. The polymerization with the light may be a little difficult because of the depth. So usually these deep cavities, we recommend higher light. Or if you want to get really sophisticated in your biomimetic techniques, you can get a glass rod. I mean, this is obviously not a glass rod. This is just a pen, but pretend like this was a glass rod. You're not going to use it as a post, which it was created for, because we don't use posts. We don't use pins in a biomimetic approach. But if you put this glass rod into the preparation, shine the light here, the light goes 5-6 millimeters deep, which sometimes these dissections are 5-6 millimeters deep, even deeper. But that polymerization with the light of the hybrid layer is done as a light cure procedure. That hybrid layer now is starting to polymerize. That polymerization will only be decreased in strength if composite that's thick enough to form a center of mass that can pull away from that hybrid layer, weakens that hybrid layer. So what would be the best way to do that? Bulk fill this high C-factor prep, put the light on it. All of a sudden, parts of the hybrid layer would be weakened, stretched, or even destroyed. You know, that's not what you do. Okay, so first you got your IDS, and then you're going to put a half millimeter of flowable. And when you put the half meter below of flowable, if that preparation is only 3 millimeters wide, then you can see that a half millimeter on each side takes away 1 millimeter of the distance between the two walls. So they're getting close together, but they're not connected. And more importantly, the bottom is not connected to the top, which may be the difference between root dentin or deep dentin and superficial dentin, which has a gradient of hydroxyapatite. And so when you have that half millimeter and you get the light cure, you put the light on, again, you can put in a glass rod to get that light activating the half millimeter of resin coating more efficiently. That's a great technique. But at some point, you're kind of limited. If you put a layer of composite in now, even if it's a small increment of small size, you're going to be connecting the walls. And the Alleman-Delaperre rule is you do not connect walls of different layers of hydroxyapatite, which we call the hierarchy of bondability, for at least 5 minutes. So it's only taking you a minute and a half to put in the resin coating. So all you have to do is go do something else. That's called decoupling by coffee break. Or you can take a photograph. That's called decoupling with photography. But the idea is that you just let the maturation of the hybrid layer and the resin coating happen for 5 minutes before you start putting in a connecting layer of composite. After the 5 minutes, then you layer the bottom with a small increment. We use delibits, which are 1.5 increments. Olibits are too big in this situation, so I recommend half of a delibit, which would be 0.75 millimeters. And as you push that in with the brush, you know, it will connect the walls, but you're still going to be basically in the same hierarchy of bondability. The same deep dentin will be connecting to deep dentin. And then you light cure that. Again, you could use a light rod to help speed that up. And then the next layer would just be more superficial dentin. There really wouldn't be a difference of pull on both sides, but you've already waited the 5 minutes for your hybrid layer. And so these very difficult high C factor are just maintaining the maximization of their bond strength by waiting a period of time before the restoring composite starts connecting the walls and kicking in the forces that we call C factor forces. And, you know, this science has been studied since 1987. So you're talking about we're getting close to 35 years. And that 35 years has shown that this is something that if you neglect, you will lose half of your bond strength in any size of prep that you use. But if your prep is only enamel, that's a different situation. Your preps are hardly ever only enamel. That's called incipient dentistry. If your patient base is only incipient dentistry, you would probably be the only one in the world. But, you know, it makes your life easier. But as we work into these areas where we actually have deep decay, or the areas where we actually have deep cracks that need to be dissected, or you're in areas that have deep boxes with different levels of the hierarchy of bondability, then these tools of decoupling with time, fiber placement, limited volume increments of composite in the restorative process, all of these work together to make it so no matter what challenge you're presented with, you have the tools to systematically approach that. But it all starts with the hybrid layer, and if you're using a self-etch system, the SuperDentin. So till next time, I think next time is episode 4. We will see you. Get bonded, stay bonded. Always great talking to you.